lose your sense. Use what you got from coincidence. Hear me now. Sooner or later, you're gonna have to stand up tall. Sooner or later, when your back's against that wall. Sooner or later, you'll have to be the one you are. And you just might find that you're out of time, and it's just too late.
You're listening to Leid Stories. I'm Eutrice Leid, and that was Jimmy Cliff with Sooner or Later. It's from his 1973 album, Struggling Man. Well, we have quite a challenge before us, it seems, and it's getting more and more bizarre every single day. But we have to start somewhere. And in terms of dealing with it, and the best place, in fact, the most effective place to start is with ourselves. What is this that we are experiencing here? And as you see every day, the effort is to normalize it. Of course, in the first few days, all these aberrations are the topic of discussion. What is Trump doing? What is Sanders doing? What is this one doing? And where is all of this leading? But we don't know what the it is. What is it? We don't know. There are people who know, but of course, it's not in their interest to discuss it. Because in this environment, the more confused the people are, the better it is. They can fight among themselves because that narrows the field. They don't have too many people to convince. And essentially, they both know, both sides, or all sides know what they're fighting for. We are the ones who don't know what it is that they're fighting for, and what stake do we have in all of this? But one thing that we are sure of is that we are not ready for whatever it is. We're not ready to deal with it. They are the ones making the rules. They are the ones who know where they want to go, what they want to happen. They have the resources to make it happen, and we don't. We are like spectators in this macabre sport. So I'm asking you today, what have you ascertained so far as the, what is the plan? What is happening in this country? How is it supposed to affect us, or how is it affecting us? Because it's already begun. Whatever this is, it's already begun. And could we get our arms around this period that we're in? Is there a way to categorize it and to define it so that we have some chance of understanding not only what is happening to us, but how best to cope with it, how best to respond to it in our own interests? We are being wafted all over the place. We're going wherever the current takes us, and the current, by that I mean whoever is winning at the moment. We know it's a horrible sport, but it is a sport to them. We have to decide what it is what are we in for? Do we want to be part of this? Are we equipped to fight? How do we fight if we think we can cope with this? How do we begin to fight? Something that is always changing, so dynamic. We have the most recent decision by the president to just pull troops out of northern Syria, and we still don't know what that means. How does it affect us? What is it that we're in for? And I think we would be kidding ourselves if we begin to pretend that we are part of this America, the part of America that supposes that we know what is going on and we'll just take orders as to how we are supposed to cope or behave. We don't know what tools we have. We have no idea what in this fight. Where are our interests? We're not prepared, plain and simple. We're not prepared. And that leaves us open to all kinds of manipulation. So many chances to make wrong decisions, uninformed decisions. Decisions that are not in our interests at all. And we don't know how to fight. This kind of fight, we don't know how to do that. Our leaders have just scattered. They don't want the responsibility of leadership at this time because they too have no idea where we are going. What exactly is in our, meaning our community's interests? How do we fight the state that we're in? It's amorphous, it changes minute by minute, hour by hour, day by day. And still we don't know what it is. The news people are reporting as if they know what it is. And therefore, after filing their reports, the assumption is we now know what it is, but we have no idea. There are no clearly defined issues. We have no idea if you have to choose a side, which side you're going to choose. We have no idea what is the planned mission here and all of this and this confusion and chaos and people seemingly not knowing what they're doing, but yet they seem to have a predictable outcome. They seem to know what they desire that outcome to be. What do we know? We don't know anything. But you know, we can't start today. Let's try that as an example of what we can do. And that is come to terms, be absolutely clear and realistic about what our situation is. What is our situation? Do we have any power to change it? Do we have any influence over it? Or is it so big that we have no idea of how to approach a solution? So we've been lying to ourselves, we're deceiving ourselves, we're going along with their deception because they are convincing us that we know what we're doing, that we're clear where they are going. That's where I want us to focus today. To deal with this matter honestly, we have no idea where we're going. We have no idea where we are. We cannot definitively state what, in the scheme of things that are in play now, what's best for us, what's not best for us. What should we invest our time and money and support in? Or do we just float on the ocean, you know, like the discarded plastic? Wherever the current carries us, that's where we're going. We have no preset expectations. We have no plans. We have no ways of punishing a deliberately errant system that has its own agenda, and that's all that it's interested in. They're taking care of their business. Are we taking care of ours? Do we know what our business is? Or are we still stuck in that primordial space called survival? Aren't we? Isn't it time that we move beyond that? That we see to the basic survival? No, we're entitled to more than that. We should have a far more sophisticated approach, far more sophisticated explanations and decisions that need to be made. So that's where we're going today. What, in your view, how would you characterize the state of affairs as it affects you and the group that you identify with as a whole? What is the state of affairs? And it's useless to ask, well, how did it get this way? We start off with, it is this way. You don't have to argue, how did we get here? We're here. That's the main thing. But where is here? And since we are here, how do we relate to being here in this place? That's our charge today. Are you up to it? Let's see if you're up to it. If you're up to it, you'll call 888-874-4888 and get to the point. We have no time to waste today. Get to the point. You know what I'm asking. It's a question that we all should be asking. What is this place that we're in now? How do we relate to it? How do we navigate within this space? What do we have to be prepared to do? And can we do it? from New Jersey. I'm not sure how to pronounce your name. Is it Chers?
Chris?
Oh, sorry, it's Chris. That's a typo. It's Chris. Chris from New Jersey. How are you?
I'm doing very well. Thank you, Yatrice. Good to talk to you.
Excellent. So, now, how are you relating to this question as to where we are? We talk about us all the time, but what is the space that we are occupying politically? How do you identify it? And how do we respond to our present conditions?
Well, it's chaos and confusion, as you already said. And unfortunately, I think I'm not the only one in the situation as to the mode that I find myself in, which is survival. Basic survival. Working, whatever, 10, 12 hours a day, paying the bills, catching up with debt, raising the kids. Although I try to be on top of it and I get my daily dose of reality with Leid Stories, I feel like, how can we change things? And the only way I see things changing is massive shutdown of the system. Like, everybody got to be on the street, like a majority, to shut this thing down. But other than that, I'm stuck in survival mode. That's just the reality. I hardly have the energy to and dealing with the house.
I know what you mean. You're being pulled all over the place. And do you feel that you're in command, even if you're in survival mode? Do you feel that you have command over your situation, or do you believe you are at the mercy of the situation?
Both, but I think it's leaning more at the mercy, and every day is a challenge to control the things that I can control. What I buy, what I eat. How much time I'm spending on TV, what I'm teaching the kids, that I have control over, immediate control over. But the system is pulling me out of the home, you know, 12 hours a day. That's just what it is. Like for me, with the thing that keeps me up at night is that one of the things is that student loan debt. That $1 trillion student loan debt. Everybody that's in that boat is on social media and talking and posting stuff, but I don't see no organization, no action being taken to impact and change that situation. Uh-huh. And as far as like the whole political thing that's happening with the impeachment and everything like that, that every time I see that, I think about what we talk about here on Leid Stories, about making sure that the, you know, the individual personal survival. And of course, from there, from the household, it branches off into the community and keeps going wider and wider. But I think a lot of people are just stuck on that immediate survival. Too many of us is on automatic pilot and just going and not doing any independent research to find out or get as close to the truth of what's happening. But the people who are awake, it's like, what can we do? What can we do? What can we do? I'm busy just trying to pay next month's bills and keep my head above water.
I see. How does that make you feel?
I feel disempowered in a sense. If I let it take me there, but I try to focus on what I do have control over, which is, like I said, what I buy, what I eat, what I teach the kids, that I have control over. I can't really control the fact that how the system is pulling all of us and taking away our ability to develop as human beings and actually participate in this so-called democracy to impact the system. It's set up that way. Can it be changed? Yes, I believe it can, but it's like a drastic big action has to take place in order for the change to come. And I don't feel that enough people is like in enough pain for that to happen.
Wow. This is very insightful, Chris. I think you have a good handle on it. Does it make you feel angry, or does it make you feel good that as bad as things are, you're reasonably clear about what you have to do for yourself and for your family, and you see yourself making a way, but as you look at the bigger picture, how do you see it?
I feel all of those things, like hopeful, angry, anxious, helpless, but at the same time, trying to always stay in a positive mind frame. In the bigger picture, I'm always thinking about what is the next big catastrophe that's gonna happen, that's gonna drastically change things for the worse for everybody.
What do you see that as being right now? That very thing you just said. What is the thing that could make things worse?
Something big, in like nature-wise, something that's gonna knock out the electrical grid power, or maybe some type of 9/11 scenario that's gonna implement, you know, even more police repression, something like that. But in the meantime, it's like grinding, keeping my nose down, staying out of trouble, under the radar, and constantly trying to maneuver in this system.
What in this moment gives you a sense of accomplishment and joy?
What gives me that feeling is that aside from all the financial crisis that I'm in as far as debt, one thing is that I know that I'm not the only one, and two, that I put my children's education at the forefront and making sure that they are clear about a lot of things from now, as far as racism, who they are, what the system is about, and always guiding them and to think about those aspects of life. That I feel good about.
Well, Chris, you've given us a pretty unique view by opening up this window into your life to share with us. And it's been very, very instructive. And I thank you for being generous to share it with us today. I hope people are listening, because there's great value in what you're saying. And there's great common sense in what you're saying. Because the way you defined survival, we see that there is also accompanying your thinking about it, you're thinking about ways to make it happen. So thanks so much for calling in and sharing today. Bill from Brooklyn, you're on the air.
Good Good afternoon, Utrice, and to the community.
Hello, Bill.
Yeah. Hi, good afternoon. First of all, I'm a patriot. I grew up in D.C. I worked on Capitol Hill as a kid, and I literally just walked the halls of Congress as a 14, as a teenager, working in a senator's office, Senator Edward M. Kennedy. So I truly consider myself a patriot, and I am not in a survival mode at this point. I'm more in a rescue mode in terms of rescuing this democracy from the tyrant that now sits at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. And we have examples of that of all over the world, from Puerto Rico to Russia to Hong Kong and Haiti. People must take to the streets at some point, not so much in terms of overthrowing the government, but to literally rescuing this government from the madman that is in the White House right now and an inept Congress that refuses to act accordingly in terms of what the Constitution requires. So that's my position right now. And so it's just about activating that in ways that make sense and finding others of like mind. And I have a dream of just 5 million people just descending en masse in Washington, D.C., and just taking the city over, surrounding the White House, and demanding that man and Mr. Pence leave the city post-haste. So that's where I'm at this point, because things have gotten to a level of just being just unimaginable that this is the United States in 2019, and this is what we have to deal with.
When you describe yourself as a patriot, implicit in that definition is that you expect at some point to be in direct confrontation with the established order, which means war, which means conflict. Do you recognize that?
Yes, I recognize that's what it's coming to. With the examples of Martin Luther King, but at the same time with the example of Malcolm X and others, even outside of this country, Che and so forth. Now, by no means am I say that level of a revolutionary, but at some point people are pushed to activating themselves in terms of really doing what's necessary. Not just for their mere survival to receive the crumbs that, you know, that the establishment would throw at us, but to really, you know, take the bull by the horns and take possession as is required, as is our right of this country, of this democracy. And yes, I would be arm in arm with folks, en masse. Like just, I was there with the Million Man March, and I can imagine that 10 times that. You know, a 10-person march, a 10-American march, because that is what it is coming to if things do not change very quickly. We see that Mr. Trump is devolving into more and more madness each and every day, almost proclaiming himself to be untouchable, almost an emperor of sorts. And so what's the alternative? I mean, what will he do next?
Well, people would say in our so-called democracy, we have ways of addressing that. We have Congress, we have voting, we have all kinds of ways in which we can assert our rights as citizens. Why do you select this way, the patriot way?
Each of those ways, that at least most of them that you have cited, have failed utterly. We have inept Congress people on both sides of the aisle, except for a very few. You mentioned in the past Congressman Green in Texas. He was one of the first to rise up. And now we have others, Ocasio and so forth. But they're just a handful. And the courts, we really can't really have any much faith in that, considering the makeup of the courts. So the measures that you've cited are failing, and unless there is a sea change very quickly, then I really think there will be no alternative. And speak, we see the examples of people revolting against despot governments all over the world. In Hong Kong, we saw how the folks in Puerto Rico literally drove out a government that was against them. And in Haiti, as we speak now, which is not covered in the media, there's almost a near revolution going on there. It's a world almost, I won't say in total revolt, but we have examples of what people are driven to when their governments fail them utterly.
Uh-huh. Where would you start?
I would start locally, grassroots. I mean, we have to, that's where all movements began. And I am, in my own way, going to try to find others of like mind. I have a congressman here in Brooklyn, and I over a year ago, I mentioned to him, it's like when Trump was beginning his madness, it's like, why don't you just get, busloads, 3 or 4 busloads of people from Brooklyn? You would have no problem filling it up and going on the steps of CAP, bringing them down to D.C. and standing with you, Congressman Hakeem Jeffries, on the steps of the U.S. Capitol and standing up against this man. All he could do was hand me his card. So that's a total failure, a total cop-out. And he's under, the skirt of Ms. Pelosi and refuses to make any movement without her. And he's not the only one. So it begins locally, and I think that we'll be seeing more and more of those types of examples of people finally collectively coming together and communicating together and finding ways to mobilize.
You talked earlier about systems, political systems that have failed and that are still failing. And the political party is one.
Sure.
If you were to be able to implement, as you just described, a change, would that necessarily mean that the parties themselves would have to come under attack?
Hello?
Yes, I'm listening.
Oh, yes, I lost you. Yes, that is absolutely essential. This two-party system has been an utter failure. Excuse me, has not served the needs of most Americans and are in cahoots with big business and big governments nationally and globally. And so, yes, that is a beginning. There has to be an expansion of more opportunities for people of divergent political belief systems to participate fully and to be able to elect representatives on a local and national level, for sure. And it can't be mealy-mouth kind of efforts such as green parties that pop up, every once in a while and then disappear and you never hear from them again. And so it's got to be something that really is organized to find real common sense solutions for alternative political movements and parties in the United States.
Okay. I just want to ask you one more thing, and that is where, if you had your way to get started, how would you start and where would you start and what would be the beneficial advantage of it?
Well, first is that I'd have to find people who are fearless, because what we're talking about is it's not a revolution per se it's a revolution of the mind, and to find people who are fearless in thinking about really confronting this failure of the system, and to organizing, and to being able to step out of the shadows, and to begin to mobilize in lawful ways that's protected by the constitutional law, and to then grow. And as we've seen, I mean, on any given day in this country, you have people having flash mobs and doing all kinds of things artistically and otherwise. And there'll be, right, someone said if they wanted to have a flash mob and, you know, in Central Park and have 10,000 people there by 5 o'clock this afternoon, that could happen. And so, it's just about getting the word out and finding people who are fearless and ready to really take a stand and to take action.
Well, thank you so much, Bill, for contributing some very, very important points, worth consideration, I think, and urgently, because we're in
thank
a bad
you.
Way.
Yes,
would you agree with that?
Yes. And thanks for all that you yes. do, Beatrice.
Thank you. We are in a bad way. We need all the help we can get to mobilize people and to bring them to a clear understanding
Absolutely.
As to where we are as a group.
Yes, yes, indeed.
Thanks
Thank
for calling in. 888-874-4888 is the number to call. We're running close to time. But we have to talk about this. We cannot ignore it and just assume that, well, people will see over time that it makes sense to think this way or that way. We don't have that kind of time. We don't have the luxury of that time. We have to act. And I mean, when a leading country of the world can reach the point where you have a president who clearly has major mental problems in office, and they're doing everything to keep him there, and they're making his nonsensical policies look like, well, it makes sense. It's brilliant. The whole country technically could be said to be going mad, because we're living in the madness every day. We have to contend with it, but we're not contending with it in the sense that we are saying, listen, you need help. You need to go somewhere to get the help you need. But we cannot allow you to hold the entire country hostage. We cannot allow this madness to continue. We have people going off on their own financial adventures. They're operating essentially like big-time gangsters and crooks. They have no love for this country or anybody else but themselves. And we have seen a descent into madness and chaos. We have not seen this before. Not at this level, not to this degree. So it means that it is institutionalized. People now have new definitions for what politics is supposed to be, what government is or supposed to be. And these definitions are outrageous. And the whole country seems to be following suit. I could do anything I need to do to accomplish my individual goals and objectives. And, you know, if you're in the way, I have to just move you out. Move you out of the way, run over you, and get my platform done. My interests far supersede yours. You're nobody. I am somebody. This is not the way we think of the United States generally, but this is the way we think now. We see the evidence. The people who are supposed to lead are gangsters, thieves, crooks. They're for themselves. They have no sense of obligation to the country. They are pure capitalists, pure. They don't care who has to be moved out of the way, who has to be crushed. They don't care about this idea of fairness. None of that. These are absolute capitalists. They put the old-fashioned term capitalist to shame. These are people engaging in wars, in mass murders, in policies that are just unjustifiable, because at the end of it all, they get the most out of it. They get the money, they get the power, they get the influence. They get the rights that they deny others. We're in a very, very bad time. And it's getting worse because the natural assumption is that people elected to protect us from this very kind of thinking, would rush to our defense. No such thing. No such thing is happening. So we have to rev up what we have to do to not just survive, but to survive within our definitions of what is just, what is right. How do we minimize and or completely obliterate the assault, the unending assault against people who don't deserve it? So, you know, we have some thinking to do. But I agree with our callers so far who have been very generous and have guided us, even in this small conversation, the right way to think and therefore to act. But we cannot be paralyzed and expect other people to do the work. We have to invest in the things that we believe. If you believe in a just society, we have to see what your investment is, what you are prepared to do. How are you intending to contribute your 2 cents to this massive effort of lifting people up and out of this morass that we're in? And we have reason to be hopeful, because the people who have been doing these evil things to us, they're really not that smart. They're not that capable. It is just that they have situated themselves strategically, and they have an institution. They have the backing of institutions that allow them to proselytize on a mass level, where people start. They're so mad now, we're so crazy, that we think bad is good. The indefensible is defensible. That wrong is right. Right this minute in this country, that's a fight. We know that there are people who are just dead wrong about the things that they're doing and want to do. But look how many people in the United States believe it's right. They dispense with reason. They dispense with logic. They dispense with notions of justice and so forth. These are superfluous things. The question is, are you a member of the power elite? How close to the center of power are you? How can you impact another person's life? And by impacting, I mean destroy. How could you do that? And because it's a reflection of your power. You have the power to create calamity in people's lives. It is mind-boggling. Harvey from Berkeley, you're on the air.
Hi, hello, wonderful Utrecht. So remember the first guy who called, he talked about, he worried about the grid being shut off, the power grid. That was one of his worries. Well, that's what's happening here in California, where I live. PG&E, because of global baking and everything is dry and there's drought, they're going to shut off power in the Bay Area where I live, and starting tomorrow, and it's going to go on for maybe a few days, they said. There is panic now. There's panic in East Bay. Today, people are running to the stores. They're trying to buy up as much food as they can so they can get through the next few days. They're buying, you know, whatever, you know, and this is due to Trump. It's his, one of the things, instead of being a leader and leading us towards renewable energy, where it would slow down the heating up of our planet due to our uncontrolled burning of fossil fuels into the atmosphere, he's calling for more fossil fuels. In fact, they want to open up drilling in California to produce more oil, more methane, that'll heat up the planet and create more drought and more forest fires. So now PG&E, which is a central utility, they're on the radio, they're telling everybody to get ready. There's people who have disabilities, they need electricity to survive. They're telling them to go to medical centers. Meanwhile, their own website doesn't work. You call them up and it's not working. So the key here is the decentralization. This is the lesson right now, that something we can all take part in, the decentralization of the production and generation of electricity toward clean, renewable power, such as putting solar panels on your rooftop, buying an electric car and plugging it into your solar electric rooftop and powering your car by the sun, wind power, wave power, thermo generation, geo generation of electricity, the battery technology. We have all these technologies, but our current government is repressing them. He's not a leader. He's, you know, I mean, if we were to be attacked, and things that are happening like droughts and storms and hurricanes and the damage that's going on in America, this, you know, if we were an outside source doing that, we would call them the enemy. But it's our own government and the Republicans and the Trump who is pushing for more of this destructive energy use that's destroying America, taxing our people, taxing our taxes, and meanwhile we give, I think this year we gave something on the tune of $750 billion to the military industrial complex rather than invest a good portion of that into our infrastructure to secure our infrastructure. Instead of building walls that separate our country from Mexico, we should build walls to slow sea rise along our coastal areas. I mean, this is a wrong way Charlie we have in the White House, and I do believe that you have to be absolutely mad to not see what's happening here. So he and his crew are just paid dupes for the fossil fuel industry. And so here in California right now, we are going through, we're just about to start where I live, energy blackouts. And that means that everybody is going to be in dire straits. They're going to be in harm's way. I think even the streetlights won't work. There's going to be, and the police are just going to be overworked like crazy.
Well, we are experiencing some of that now. Many parts of the country going through these experiences. I was told about today in New York City, which affected the program, you know, having blackouts, internet blackouts. So these things are already happening. But we've come to the end of the program today, and I just want to thank you sincerely for contributing and encouraging us to think differently about our empowerment. We'll see each other tomorrow. Thank you so much for today.